In a previous life, I designed and managed the implementation of new retail store spaces, which gave me just the tiniest taste of how rewarding it must be for an architect to see their creation move from a concept on paper or screen all the way through to a fully built end product. You do get a tangible result that brings a huge sense of achievement. I guess that's why so many architects prefer to create brand new structures from scratch. And as we saw in our recent video about Passivhaus standards, new builds also offer the opportunity to include the kind of energy efficiencies that'll be crucial to a more sustainable future. But there's another stream of architectural work that's much less glamorous and arguably far more important from an environmental point of view. And that's the enormously difficult task of retrofitting existing buildings. According to the website Architecture 2030, existing buildings generate nearly 40% of annual greenhouse gas emissions, and about two-thirds of the buildings that are standing today will still be there in 2050. So this week I'm having a think about how the architectural and building industry is responding to these big challenges and what the average homeowner can do to create energy savings in their existing property to get themselves moving towards that all-important Passivhaus standard. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. I'm sure quite a lot of you folks watching this programme will, like me, have dreamt of creating your perfect living space at some point in your life. But not many of us will ever get the opportunity to build our own home from scratch. And of course there are others who love the home and neighbourhood they're already living in and wouldn't want to move anyway, but who have houses that don't meet any of the energy certification requirements and that are costing them a fortune in fuel bills each year. And then there's the rapidly growing number of people living in rented accommodation and social housing as a result of the societal move towards greater urbanisation and the relentless rise in property prices. The vast majority of those buildings will need to be radically overhauled as part of the global drive towards greater sustainability over the coming decades. So retrofitting looks set to become a crucial activity, not just for private owner-occupiers, but also for landlords and municipal authorities. Retrofitting isn't just about bolting some add-ons like solar panels to your roof to reduce your electricity bills, although that is an extremely good idea in its own right. No, it's really predominantly aimed at greatly reducing energy consumption in the first place by significantly improving the fabric of the building itself to increase its thermal performance and comfort. The challenge is knowing how far to go and how much comfort and performance any retrofit measures will genuinely deliver. The industry bods have two levels of improvement that they generally refer to. The first is called a shallow retrofit, which is fairly superficial and may only mean bumping up the insulation in your loft and fitting a more efficient boiler. The second level, unsurprisingly, is called a deep retrofit, and it's a whole different ballgame altogether. So how do you know which category your works fall into and what standards are in place to assess them? Well, we already know about the Passivhaus standard, but it's almost always physically impossible to reach that lofty goal in an already existing building that wasn't designed that way in the first place. So some allowances have to be made, and those are reflected in a globally recognised refurbishment standard called Enerfit, and a couple of European spin-offs called Outfit and Eurofit. See what they did with the PH there? Genius! On existing buildings, architects are limited by geometry, orientation and structure. There may also be thermal bridges that are difficult to completely eliminate and that provide a path for heat to escape through gaps in existing insulation. The Enerfit standard takes all that into account and sets a lower performance level than Passivhaus, which can be summarised like this. The building has to achieve a space heating and cooling demand of 25 kilowatt hours per square metre per year, compared to the 15 kilowatt hours per square metre per year required for Passivhaus certification. It also has to reach an air tightness of 1 air change per hour instead of 0.6 under the Passivhaus standard. So retrofitting is not easy, and while Enerfit is not as strict as Passivhaus, it's still a pretty tough standard to achieve. The first thing to aim for is a high level of internal or external insulation, not just in the walls, but also below the ground floor and in the roof spaces. Retrofitters have to calculate very carefully where to install insulation to achieve the best results without causing other consequential problems. And that's trickier than it sounds. For example, if you just stick a bunch of insulation on the interior side of a wall, you might make the room warmer, but you'll also inevitably make the external wall colder. And if that wall is made of a porous material like breeze blocks or some types of brick, then you could be blocking off its ability to get rid of moisture, which can result in damp and mould, which you don't want. So if an external wall is very exposed to the elements, then the internal insulation may not be your best bet, and you'll probably have to consider adding a layer of insulation onto the outside surface, which will then typically require a rendered finish. You'll also need to install high-performance triple glazed windows and external doors, and the designers will usually need to consider how they can make significant improvements to the insulation and taping around the window and door frames and cavities as part of any new installation. Once you've achieved these improvements in the ceiling of the building envelope, then just like with Passivhaus design, a mechanical ventilation and heat recovery, or MVHR system, will need to be installed. You may also be well advised to replace your existing heating system with a ground or air source heat pump, which is something we've looked at a couple of times on this channel, and I'll leave links to those videos in the description box below here. If you are going to take the plunge though, and go through the pain of gutting your home to make these major investments in future-proofing, then there's probably not much point in skimping. The benefit of using the Enerfit certification as your benchmark is that you'll be forced to comply with the rigour and quality assurance that the standard demands. And that means you'll likely need to employ an experienced team of designers and builders who know how to carry out the works to ensure that the air tightness performance is achieved and that there are no hidden shortcuts taken at any stage in the process. The Enerfit certification process is exactly the same as Passivhaus certification. To meet the requirements, the project must be designed using something called the Passivhaus Planning Package, or PHPP, which is a software-based calculation tool used by architects and planners to assess a building's heating, cooling, and primary energy demands and recommend appropriate levels of remedial works. And the finished project has to be certified by an accredited Passivhaus certifier. The cost of an Enerfit retrofit will obviously vary greatly from building to building and from country to country. So if you're thinking of embarking upon a project, then you should seek the advice of your local Passivhaus organisation. Fortunately, Passivhaus is now pretty much a global standard, so you should have no difficulty getting guidance for your own project. And again, I'll leave links to some of those websites in the description box below. As a very rough rule of thumb though, according to the UK Home Building and Renovation website, a deep Enerfit standard retrofit budget will likely be somewhere between £800 and £1,000 per square metre, with an MVHR unit installation for an average size house coming in at about £10,000 and triple glazed windows and doors costing around £400 to £600 per square metre. The bulk of the rest of the cost comes from the labour-intensive work to install all the insulations, membranes and intricate tapings around protrusions and junctions that ensure the airtightness measures required to get certification. That work is very time-consuming and it has to be done with great care because much of it is covered up after it's completed, and you really don't want remedial works at the end of a project like this. There's no question it's a big financial commitment, but depending on where you live, there may well be grants and incentives available from state or national government. Over in Ireland, for example, homeowners can get as much as 50% of their retrofit costs subsidised by that country's Sustainable Energy Authority. And that level of central funding is really something that needs to form part of the green recovery plans in every developed nation in the world. A deep retrofit project can take a building from an energy performance certificate rating as low as F or G, which is basically a damp, leaky shell that's impossible to keep warm in cold weather, all the way up to an A-rated home that comes somewhere close to the energy efficiency of a purpose-built Passivhaus construction, potentially reducing energy demand by 80% and carbon dioxide emissions by 90%. People who've gone through the process talk about the transformation in their comfort and health, with a constant year-round ambient temperature within the whole home and a lovely, crisp, clean air supply from the ventilation system, all achieved with negligible heating and cooling bills. And of course, once you've got your official certification, you will have significantly improved the value and marketability of your home. In truth, the world is miles behind where it should be in applying these energy saving measures to domestic and public buildings. But awareness is growing and the Refurbishment Standard is gaining traction in many parts of the world. Examples of successful retrofits are easy to find online at websites like Passivhaus Accelerator, who've got an entire section specifically dedicated to case studies from all over North America and the wider world. I'd highly recommend this interview with James Traynor from the Royal Institute of British Architects, who's written a book all about the Refurbishment Standard. And of course, there are numerous YouTube videos showcasing successful retrofit projects from the United States, Canada, the UK, Europe, and Australia, to name just a few. And many local authorities are now also beginning to understand their obligations as part of the climate emergency to invest heavily in major improvements to their social housing stock, much of which hasn't been touched for decades. Some of those buildings have become so badly insulated and leaky that the residents simply can't afford to pay the huge costs of heating their apartments properly. The consequence of that is a level of persistent cold and damp that in many cases is causing chronic respiratory illnesses in long-term tenants. We talk about some pretty amazing technological breakthroughs on this channel, which will no doubt be very important for reaching net zero carbon emissions by 2050. But many of the best solutions don't rely on fancy new machines or ambitious and unproven geoengineering concepts. They're right in front of us, hidden in plain sight, as they say. Investing rapidly, efficiently, and effectively in our existing buildings and national infrastructures will not only massively drive down greenhouse gas emissions, but it'll also create hundreds and thousands of well-paid jobs for at least a generation to come. Now, if you've been through a deep retrofit yourself and you've got some top tips that others could benefit from, or if you have direct experience of working in the passive house and deep retrofit industry, then dive down to the comment section below and leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. This channel would be impossible to maintain without the amazing folks over at the Just Have a Think Patreon page. They enable me to keep the channel completely independent and keep these videos 100% ad-free. And I'm immensely grateful for the support they provide. And I must just give a quick shout out to the folks who've joined since last time with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Glenn Little, Ty Haller, Shahaf Benita, LJ Neeson, Andrew Tech, Mike Howe, Byron Wolfe, Rashid Mustafa, Stephen Lieb, Robert Dockstatter, Lawrence Kearns, Mike Hopkins, Mark Fermor, Matty C, Andrew Rufiner, Oliver Reinhard, Robert Uttard, and Joanne Gellius. And of course, a big thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. You can get involved in that and get the opportunity to exchange ideas and information, plus watch exclusive monthly news updates from me, and have your say on future programmes in monthly content polls by visiting www.patreon.com/justhaveathink. And you can hugely support the channel absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button and notification bell. Dead easy to do all that. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.